How important it is that we as Christians today go public with our faith. How many know in the day that we're living today, there's a lot of hopelessness, a lot of confusion. There's a lot of crazy stuff happening in our nation. You know, we just had a Supreme Court justice die, and they're telling our president, you can't have another nominee until the next, election. And it's interesting, but then our own governor gets executive powers, and he just slaps everyone with this harsh thing that if I catch you, I'm going to fine you, and it's like it doesn't seem to make sense sometimes. Well, whether this world makes sense or not, those of us who are Christ followers, we're the only ones that have an answer. And it's important that we be ready to give an answer to people who are looking for meaning in this life. Because without Christ, life really does seem cruel. Doesn't make sense at all. But Jesus Christ has us here so that we would bring an answer to those that are looking. Not everyone is looking. Not everyone will appreciate you sharing your faith. But you never know what God will do if you would open your mouth and share what Christ has done in your heart. Amen. So open your Bibles with me to 1 Peter, please. 1 Peter chapter 3. And we're going to start in verse 12, Janelle. 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 12. And this week and next week, I want to talk about going public with your faith, sharing the gospel of Christ and what he has done in your life. So we can read it right behind me here. For the eyes of the Lord are on the righteous, and his ears are open to their what? Amen to that. But the face of the Lord is against those who do evil. And who is he who will harm you if you become followers of what is good or Christ? But even if you should suffer for being a Christ follower, for righteousness' sake, you are blessed. And do not be afraid of their threats, nor be troubled, but sanctify the Lord God in your hearts, and always be ready to give a defense or an answer to everyone who asks you for the reason of the hope that is in you, with meekness and fear. Having a good conscience that when they defame you as an evildoer, how many know just because you're called a Christian doesn't mean they're going to honor you. They're going to call you evildoers for being a Christ follower, all right? Those who revile your good conduct in Christ may be ashamed, and we'll stop right there. That's good. Let's pray. Father, in Jesus' name, I pray, Lord, that you would help us to grow that faith in our lives where what we know to be true in our hearts will come out of our mouths to help others in this difficult life that we live. We pray, Father, in Jesus' name, that you would help us to be beacons of light to those, Lord God, who are walking in darkness. Help us not to be ashamed, Lord, as Laura and Caesar were not ashamed today. And Lord, help us to take it outside this church to our family and our friends and our co-workers. We ask in Jesus' name, amen. That's the drain, I guess. All right. We'll wait just a second. Reminder, don't drain next time during the sermon. A, put it up there. Insights on evangelism. I'm going to give you two of them this week and two of them next week. Roger, maybe go down and shut that off if you would. Thank you. Let's go to number one. Why should we tell other people about Jesus Christ? How do we do that? How does that work out? Well, first of all, if you had the cure for cancer, if you had the cure for AIDS, if you had the cure for COVID-19 and told no one, wouldn't you say that is just criminal? Well, you need to know that we have the cure for this life, and it's Jesus Christ. And when we don't open our mouths and tell people, isn't that just as criminal? We have an obligation to share with people what's different about us and why we live the way we live, why we go to church, why we raise our kids different, why we take stands against things. And so it's important that you understand when we share Christ, it really begins with your relationship with Jesus, because if you're not growing in Christ, you're not going to share Christ, are you? But if you, like the word this morning, the tongue and the interpretation this morning, sanctify Christ in your heart, it ought to come out. It should come out. That doesn't mean it needs to come out every day, every minute of the day. But when there are opportunities that people are hurting and people have a train wreck, people are just really brokenhearted and they're crying out, that's a sign for us to let the hope that is in us flow to them. Go to the scripture, please, if you would. The next scripture. It says sanctify, or another word for sanctify could be prioritize. Prioritize the Lord God. That's Jesus, capital L, small O-R-D. Jesus in your heart. Do you know that when you serve Christ, every day you have to reprioritize that day to put Christ in it? Do you know if you don't choose Christ in your heart that day, the day just gets filled up? Things just start happening. I find when I read my Bible first and I pray, now that's the way I am. My wife, she's a night owl. Her best time is at night, so she does it at the end of the day. I can't do that. When I do mine at the beginning of the day, my day goes smoother. Just goes a little bit smoother. And so I prioritize Christ in my heart at the beginning of the day, and life goes smoother. It's kind of like missing church. How many find out that when you miss church, that week doesn't seem to go as smooth? Now, you may have a valid reason for missing church. Doesn't matter. Still, when I don't go to church, it just doesn't seem to go as smooth. It's sanctifying the church. It's sanctifying the Sabbath. It's sanctifying Christ in your heart. And that's the most important thing when it comes to evangelizing. All right? That when you tell them about Jesus Christ, he's in your heart. He's not just in your mouth. He's in your heart. Amen. The second thing I'd like to talk to you about, insights on evangelism, is witnessing is really a lifestyle. All right. Now, some people go out and they go to prisons, and I'm so glad. Some people go street ministering, and I'm so glad. Some people will pick a day of the week and just going to go evangelize, and I'm grateful for that. But telling people about Jesus Christ ought to be a part of your life, like the alarm going off, getting up, eating, showering, getting ready for work. It's just a part of your lifestyle. And sometimes it's convenient to share Christ, and how many know sometimes it's inconvenient? I find with me, it's inconvenient because my flesh wants to do something else rather than to share Christ with people sometimes. So you die to yourself and you say, you know what? I don't know if they're going to get saved. I don't know if I'm sowing a seed. I don't know if I'm fertilizing a seed. I don't know if I'm watering a seed. But I need to open my mouth and say something. Next scripture. Always be ready to give a defense to everyone who asks you a reason for the hope that is in you with meekness and fear. You know, sometimes people say, what's different about you? How many of you got to be ready? All right? It'd be nice if it's always that easy, but sometimes it's not that easy. You notice someone else is hurting and you say, hey, can I talk to you? You don't seem to be on your A game today. What's going on? And you use it as an opportunity, as a lifestyle. All right? Now, there are seven different ways you can share your faith. I'm going to go over three of them, and then next week I'll go over the other four. Seven ways that people in the Bible shared their faith. And I hope you find one of these ways is more in line with your personality and the gifts that God has given to you. You may not have all of these, but you'll fit into one of these. And then you have to be comfortable in the way to share Jesus Christ to one another, okay? And so let's get into the different ways to share your faith. Let's go to the first one. And the first one is really the hardest one. It's the confrontational way. All right? Usually someone who's confrontational with Christ, they have the gift of evangelism. You think of Billy Graham. All right? You think of maybe Greg Laurie and some of these evangelists that they're just kind of direct. They're in your face. They're not offensive. But they know what they're saying, and they're laying it out, and they're talking to you about Adam and Eve. They blew it. Sin came into the world. Sin put us to live for ourselves and not Jesus Christ. And when we live for ourselves, life gets complicated. We need to repent of that. That's called sin. And ask God to forgive us and ask Christ to come into our heart, and that we would live for Him according to His way. For the Bible says there's a way that seems right unto man, and it leads to death. And so an evangelist, you know, I'm sure you've been and seen some, and I think of the Apostle Peter. Remember Peter on the day of Pentecost in Acts chapter 2. And the baptism, the Holy Ghost come down, and they're all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. And some Jews at that day, the day of Pentecost, were mocking them. And they said, oh, they got a little bit too much wine. Too much wine in the morning. And Peter gets up and said, we are not drunk as you suppose. And he quotes from Joel. In the last day, God will pour out His Spirit, not on tabernacles, not on temples, but something that has never been done in the history of the world, that the Holy Spirit would come upon bodies. Flesh, and He would indwell us. And He starts preaching to them, and He says, this Jesus whom you crucified, His blood made it possible, and now He's gone up to heaven, and you crucified Him. And this Bible says that they were cut to the heart. And they said, what do? We crucified our Savior and Lord. And put the next scripture up there, please. Peter says to them as an evangelist in Acts 2:38, he says, repent. And let every one of you be what? Baptized, just like we saw here. In the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of your sin. Your sin for living for yourself. And you shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. And how many people responded? 3,000 people responded that day. You know how many people rejected it? Probably just as many. Just because you go public with your faith doesn't mean everyone's going to like it. But your job is not to be the Holy Spirit. Your job is to sow the seed, which is the Word of God. Amen? So, Peter, confrontational. Maybe 10% of the body of Christ has this evangelism gift. Sometimes people, you know, they're like type A, almost obnoxious in their outgoingness, but God created them that way. He created you that way so that you would share your faith with Christ and not be ashamed. Amen? You know, I have a couple of evangelist friends, and Reese James, he's been here a few times. When he comes, I take him out. He always engages the waitress or the waiter in conversations, and they're just direct. They're just direct. And sometimes it makes us uncomfortable because that's not the way we are. You know, one time I went out with Ted Shuttlesworth. He's a well-known evangelist. And we went out to eat, and this poor waitress, she just got everything wrong. She got the drink order wrong. She got the food wrong. And after about 15 minutes, Ted said to her, he says, ma'am, he says, don't be upset. It's okay. You know, we're Christians. The food is wrong. Don't send it back. We're going to eat it. But I can tell there's something wrong with you. And is there something I can just pray for you for? Maybe because you just, you know, things aren't going well. We're not upset. Well, she started crying. I mean, waitresses usually don't cry in front of their patrons. And she started crying. And she started talking about how her husband left her for a younger woman, and she got with the kids, and she just started crying. Well, let me tell you something. He didn't lead her to the Lord, but he sowed a seed in her heart and encouraged her. And he was direct. He knew something was wrong. Many times we can tell when something's not right. But most of us, But someone with this confrontational, they'll say, "What's wrong with you?" I don't ask to be nosy. I ask because I care. All right? That's the confrontational, okay? What are the strengths? The strengths is, you know, when you talk to people, it's right at them. It's concise. It's the gospel message. It's the faith. The weakness is sometimes people don't like being confronted. People get turned off. And again, not everyone is going to like you being confrontational. But if you feel the Holy Spirit is leading you to do it, you be obedient and you leave the rest with God. You don't need to be obnoxious. You don't need to be harsh, but you do need to share. So that's the first one. How many think you have that gift, evangelism? Not too many. A few of you. Good. That's the way God made you. Don't be ashamed of that, because God uses you. God uses people. He doesn't use buildings anymore. He doesn't use utensils. He doesn't use candlesticks. He doesn't use cups. He uses people, and he wants to use you. And the Bible says in every house, there's gold, silver, and precious stones, wood, hay, and rubble. You can choose to be used as gold, silver, precious stones in the church of God, or you can be obstinate and be used as wood, hay, and rubble. You get to choose. The second way of going public with your faith is intellectual way. All right, the intellectual way. Now, if Peter was the confrontational way, this would be more like the Apostle Paul, who scholars tell us is probably possessed the greatest mind in the Western world was the Apostle Paul. He was just a genius, sat under some amazing teachers. And the Apostle Paul, basically, he wrote, you know, almost half the New Testament, concepts, logic, ideas, arguments, the doctrines of Christ, ecclesiology, that means a fancy word for how a church should be run, and eschatology, that's the end time events, which we are in today, wouldn't you agree? He laid it all out. He laid it all out, and one time he was going through, in Acts 17, the city in Athens, and all these philosophers, educated people, the upper echelon of the society, and they had all these altars and idols all around, and as he walked through, it grieved him. He realized they were living life wrong. There seems a way in life that seems right, but in the end, it leads to death. So he gets up, and he sees this altar to the unknown God. He goes, "Hey, I know who the unknown God is." And he gets up and he starts talking to them. In fact, let's go to the scripture. Paul says to them, all these philosophers, these Greek, you know, philosophy teachers, "For I was passing through and I even found an altar to the unknown God. Therefore, the one whom you worship without knowing him, I proclaim to you." And so he starts talking to them about Jesus and how Jesus is the fullness of the Godhead bodily. If you want to know who the Holy Spirit is, look at Jesus. You want to know who the Father is, look at Jesus. He is the creator of heaven and earth. And he at one time dealt with our sins and had a little more patience. But now that he sent his son down to the earth to live the life that we are to follow, he's losing patience with us, and you need to repent and get right with him. And he says you need to have self-control. And they're, "Oh, we don't like that word. Self-control. We want to live the way we want." And he says, "Not only that, you're all going to die, and there's an afterlife called the resurrection." And they went, "What? We've never heard this before." And some believed, some mocked, and most of the teachers said, "You need to come back again. We've never heard this resurrection." And it's all the intellectual part. Now, my dad and a few of the professors I had when I went to school, a lot of them told me, "Listen, Paul, You will never reach the intellectual, the educated, and the wealthy people if you don't have an education. The higher you go in education, if you're going to go in the ministry, they respect nothing in this country like education. Education is a god in this country. If you want to reach lost people who are rich, wealthy, up in the escalons, get as much education as you can. So I went, got my bachelor's, got my master's, and you know what? They're right. They're right. You reach them all. If you're called to that, you go get it, all right? And you learn your apologetics. That's a fancy way of defending your faith. Now, when I grew up, the big apologetic people was Josh McDowell. Anyone ever heard of Josh McDowell? Evidence that demands a verdict, 1 and 2. And then after that, there's another guy in the 90s, Lee Strobel. Anyone ever heard of Lee Strobel? A case for Christ, a case for the resurrection, a case for Easter, a case for Christmas. He writes out apologetically the intellectual arguments how Christ is alive. Probably my favorite one is Rabbi Zacharias. Anyone heard of him? He just died. Fabulous. Fabulous. Just amazing. He's from India. All right? And it's just amazing what he lays out, these arguments. And so that's the intellectual approach. The good thing is when you can come across someone who had one bad experience with a church, one bad experience with a Christian, one bad experience with a preacher, one bad experience with a televangelist, and they stereotype all Christians and they write them all off. And you can sit down and you can say, let's talk about this. Let me hear your arguments against Christianity and let me share them for Christianity. And so you can do that. And you have to know what you're saying. And so people like that concise argument. The negative thing is, you can argue with people till you're blue in the face, but you're not saved by logic. If Christianity was logical, everyone would be saved. It's not logical. For by grace are you saved through faith. And that not of yourself, that not of your logic, that not of your thinking. It's a gift of God. Unless the Spirit of God draws you, no man comes. For God is spirit. And they that worship him, John 4:24, must worship him in spirit and in truth. So when you argue logically with someone, there has to come a point where you say, well, do you believe you're a sinner? Are you ready to receive Jesus Christ as your Savior? That's going public with your faith. And if they say, no, I still choose not to believe. But I explain to you the proof of the resurrection of Christ. I don't care. Logic does not save people. But it does get some, doesn't it? It does get some, all right? Third one, and I'll close with this today. This is my favorite one. The testimonial approach, all right? The testimonial approach is where you share your story of how you came to Jesus Christ. Now, testimony involves three things. Your past before Christ, BC, when you received Christ, and what Jesus Christ has done in your life since you've been serving Christ. All right? It's a testimony. And everyone loves a testimony because most people like stories. Everyone likes a story. And when you share your story, you really can't deny someone's story of how they came to Jesus Christ. And so most people are more comfortable with this approach of sharing their faith. All right? Now, let me give you an example. John chapter 9, don't turn there. In John chapter 9, there's this blind beggar who would sit on the road and he would beg. And Jesus came up to him. Now, how many know he's blind? He don't know Jesus, all right? And the Holy Spirit gave Jesus 4 words of wisdom to link him to a miracle. Remember I've been talking about a word of wisdom? It's a gift of the Spirit in 1 Corinthians chapter 12. A word of wisdom is how to apply, what to do in a given situation, that if the person you're praying for obeys it, it links them to the miracle. All right? So you always get people to do things to get them in the spirit of obedience before you pray for them, so faith will bring the miracle. All right? Now, sometimes the Holy Spirit may ask you to do some word of wisdoms. They're a little uncomfortable. So Jesus spits into the dirt. Holy Spirit says, spit in the dirt. Reach down, grab some mud, go over to that blind guy, put it in his eyes, and then tell the blind man to go a half a mile down the road to the pool of Siloam and go wash. That's four words of wisdom. The Holy Spirit told Jesus to do it. If you were the blind guy, how would you have gotten to the pool of Siloam? Someone tell me. Ask. Ask someone. It's not that complicated. The guy goes to the pool of Siloam. What happens to him? He sees. What if I spit in his eyes and make mud and he doesn't see? You better know the Lord's telling you to do it. He sees. He doesn't know who did it. He just knows it's Jesus. And Jesus is not there. And people go, hey, this is the blind man begging. And they said, it looks like him. He's got the same clothes. Go ask his parents. And the Pharisees go, oh my goodness, this is a miracle. This is a miracle. How did this happen? Ask the parents. The parents, they don't want to fight with the Pharisees. They don't want to get kicked out of the church. So they said, he's old enough. You ask him. He says, this Jesus did it. He spit in the mud and he made it, put in my eyes. And I washed and I can see. And they said, that Jesus is a sinner. They'll argue with you too. And the man testified, put the scripture up there. And this is what he said. Whether he is a sinner or not, I do not know. One thing I know, though I was blind, that's the testimony. Let me tell you what Jesus did for me. I was blind, my past. Jesus, I had an encounter, and now I'm changed. How do you argue with that? Most of us are right there. How many of you say, that's me? I'd rather just share my story. That's where I kind of like myself. But it's important that you understand people want to hear your story. And let me tell you the most important thing about sharing your testimonies. No one wants to hear about your successes and your money and your education. They want to hear about your divorce, the death of your child, the car accident, the disease. They want to hear about the pain in your life. Because people can identify more with the pain than they ever can your success. So a testimony always goes in the past of what happened. My testimony. Let me share a little bit of my testimony, okay? I was raised in the church. My dad was a pastor. Both my grandparents were Christian. And I'm a third generation Christian. I'm just really blessed, all right? But I lived a life, because my dad was a pastor, kind of on my mom and dad's coattails of faith. Are you a Christian? Yeah, I'm a Christian. My grandparents were Christians. Of course I'm a Christian. How many know God has no grandchildren? John 1:12, but as many as believed on Christ, to them gave he power to become the sons of God. There are no grandchildren. Everyone has to have a personal encounter with Jesus Christ. So there came a time in my adolescence where I went through a heartbreak, and it really hurt me, and I realized, my goodness, I'm a teenager. If I can't figure out life now, how am I ever going to survive growing up? There's too much pain. And I realized I was in pain because God didn't leave me. I walked away from God. And so it's a prodigal story. I came back to God. I was in much pain. And the truth is, it took 3 years to heal up my broken heart. 3 years. 3 years. All right? I'm not going to lie to you and say someone laid hand on me and pow, I was healed and oh, it's great. 3 years it took. And God changed my course. I was going to go to university, take human kinesiology to become a chiropractor. God says, I don't want you to do that. I want you to go to Bible school. So I was accepted in 3 universities, turned them down, went to Bible school. And I said, Lord, I'd really like to get a bachelor's. The Lord gave me a bachelor's and a master's. And when I share my testimony with people, my testimony is more to the backslidden, the people who grew up in the church, but they didn't protect their hearts. And life got in, because the Bible says, guard your heart, for out of it flows the issues of life. Your life is nothing but a conglomeration of your heart. If you have a painful life, it's because you've let painful things in your heart. You got to guard that heart. You got to keep Christ in that heart. And that's what happened with me. I let some stupid things get in my heart. I hurt myself. So I came back to Christ, and when I share the testimony, if I'm sharing it with some friends that I played hockey or baseball with, I throw in sports because I was athletic. If I'm sharing with some intellectuals, I have a master's. I can use that. And I try to share them. But my ministry is mainly to the ones who once were on fire for the Lord and they've fallen away. And I say, God still loves you. He still loves the backslider. I'm proof. I wouldn't be here today if he didn't. I realize I could have blamed a lot of people for my pain, but the only person I really needed to deal with was me. And a lot of people have done me wrong. A lot of people have hurt me in my past, but that ain't going to help me. What's going to help me is sanctify the Lord Jesus Christ in your heart. Prioritize him in your heart. You've got to put him first. And it's so easy to get caught up in the game of blame game. Blame someone else. Blame this. I don't got time for this. I don't got time for that. I don't got time to go to the church. I don't got time to read the Bible. I don't got time to pray. You're not sanctifying the Lord God in your heart. And I'm telling you, it catches up to you. It catches up. It doesn't mean Christians don't go without storms and seasons. How many know the wise man built his house upon the rock, the foolish man built his house upon the sands, and the same storms, the same rains, the same floods hit both of them. But the one who stands is the one who has Christ in their heart. You still hurt. You still go through pain. People still do mean things to you. But I would rather have people do that to me and know I'm in right standing with Christ than to wonder if I have walked away from God or has God walked away from me. And that's a testimony. And everyone has one. And you need to share your testimony. What if they laugh at me? They might. They might. But you know what? Sanctify Christ in your heart. You have a living hope in you, and we need to share it. It's more important than COVID-19 answer, AIDS answer. It really is. All right? And we need to understand that. Today, we saw Caesar and Laura come forward and testify what God has done. Now, I'm proud of you both. I identify a little bit more with Caesar because he says, I went to this church and this church had some problems. It seems like when God's doing good stuff in the church, you know, the devil will get in, and it happens. That's what happens sometimes. And unfortunately, that hurt Caesar. Caesar got away from the church. It hurt him deeply. He shared some of that stuff with me. But it was last summer where we had some, the IFCA had a convention in Syracuse, and this evangelist was preaching. And God was tugging at Caesar's heart, and Caesar went down to the altar after the evangelist was confrontational, right? And I went down and I prayed with him, and God touched his heart again. He had an encounter. And you can have an encounter with God. It's just about your heart. It's about your heart. Would you bow your heads, please? Brian, if you would come. Maybe there's someone here today and you've gotten away from the Lord. Maybe you're a little mad at God because you don't appreciate what's going on in your life. And maybe you blame God, you blame others. And there may be some validity to that. But I've come to realize through my own life, it's best to sometimes search your own heart. If that's you today and you would like prayer, I'd like to pray for you. Maybe you're on a search to find out the real meaning of life, of whether serving Christ is just going to church once a week or if there's more to it. Let me tell you something, there's a lot more to it. Some people just think it's just Christ is an addition to your life. Let me tell you something, Jesus Christ is the essence of my life. He is not an addition. And that's really what it means to sanctify the Lord. And If the Lord has been speaking to you today and you would like prayer, I'm just going to ask, just raise your hand. I'm not going to embarrass you. You need some prayer today, just raise your hand nice and high so I can pray. And I'm just going to pray. Yeah. Amen. Bow your heads. And would you be in an attitude of prayer? There's a few hands that went up. Father, I pray, Lord, for these ladies that have raised their hands. And Lord, I know you had someone say over me that I would have a message to those, Lord, that were once on fire for you and life had pulled them away. And Lord, I pray for these ladies, Father. Reignite the fire of Christ in their heart. Not only that, Lord, I pray, Father, that you would help them to prioritize, sanctify, put first Christ and what it means to be a follower of Jesus Christ. Pray, Lord, that those that have been hurt by others would come to you with that hurt, would not get caught into the blame game, which is an endless cycle, pointing fingers. And Lord, I pray, Father, for a renewed conviction for a lifestyle of putting you first every day in these three ladies. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Now look at me. You got to start. Starts in the heart, all right? But it continues with your words and your actions, all right? Don't be afraid of what people say or do. Christianity is a journey. And it's not just a journey to the Bible, to prayer, to church, to serve. But it's a journey where you got to bring others along with you. Amen? Amen. Amen. I'll be praying for you three that raised your hand. All right? Keep your heart soft. Keep your heart soft.